Hi everybody, and welcome to Dragon Age Resurgence vlog number 16, and my very last one.
Oh. Dear.
Brought to you by Pain's Practical Products.
No. Just brought to you by Pain.
Practical Pain.
Yes.
A product of Practical Pain.
Yeah. Or Practical Players.
So the floor is open.
The pain's still too fresh.
It was so good, though.
It was really good. It was that
I
good
never felt of pain so good.
Creepy.
Well, let me. I guess I'll ask the players. Have any of you guys been in a tabletop situation where you have dealt with PC death? I'm just curious.
Oh yeah.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I'm just curious how you guys handled, like, your DM and you guys handled that. What did they end up doing with the player deaths, the PC deaths?
Well, I was DM.
Okay, you're DM.
and my players killed another player.
How did you
Kimberly,
handle
that's
that?
Horrible. That's horrible.
Hannah was one of those players. Hannah might have killed another player.
It wasn't just me.
I was on the same page, Hannah. I was like, wow, what jerk players would oh wait. That's
I've been part too. Of that kind of team too.
So how did you guys handle those situations then? What happened?
I just let them go, so they can tell you about
Kevin was AFK and then he came back and we killed them, so it's not really fair.
that part not so fair.
So wait, it was Kevin's character who died?
Oh no. No.
Oh okay.
No. That would be fitting though, wouldn't it? Given his tradition.
I don't know. I guess there was some betrayal and a paladin was on the team and they found out and
no, we didn't find out. We didn't find out they were a paladin. And
no. They found out there was a big chunk of that. The paladin found out that the team was betrayed during combat. So after combat, he took care of it with Hannah.
Hannah and the paladin took care of it.
Yep, Hannah and the paladin took care of it.
Hannah and the paladin. That's a new band name right there.
It wasn't a decision we made lightly. Essentially, the character went against the party in both that and in siding with the enemy. And at the time, we tied them up and interrogated them and said repeatedly, do you see the wrongness of your actions? Do you see how you went against us and are endangering us? Because the were consequences to them walking out in battle, and it made combat a lot more difficult for us. And they said about three times, I do not see the wrongness of my actions. So the paladin, who wasn't me, was another player, but I advocated for it, took it upon themselves to eliminate the player based on what their character would do.
And was this something that Like, I guess, was this something that the player was perfectly cool with? Was there a little bit of friction? I mean, I'm curious about how that went. If you don't mind me asking.
Okay. There was totally friction. Cool with it.
There was some friction.
There was
some friction.
There was friction.
Okay.
Ultimately, there was a lot of talking. After that, we all had to kind of talk as players and communicate, because at the end of the day, there's only so far you can go kind of against the party that you're playing with before they're going to leave in some capacity, whether they die or just walk out or get rejected by the team. So far, so what that person did do was make a new character and rejoin the campaign, so they didn't miss out on playing, but we saw it as completely necessary from a narrative standpoint for that player to have taken that death, considering that I was giving them the choice in and out of character. Do you see the wrongness of your actions? If you just say yes, we'll move on, we'll continue. And they didn't. They didn't take those hints. They didn't take that opportunity.
Yeah. How about you, Rachel? What was your experience? One of your experiences?
I'm gonna have to just go one.
Go ahead.
I was part of a very long Eberron campaign, and a lot of you have already heard a lot of my stories about that. But there were quite a few of us where the actual story would not continue unless the characters died, but we didn't know that until it actually happened. So when my character ended up dying, I was dealing with it and upset, and my other players were upset as well, and the DM talked with me in private, of course, and said, this is part of the story. You will be given an opportunity to come back. And in the meantime, we worked out a story-appropriate character for me to be able to keep playing, because it was like a year and a half I was playing the secondary character until I was given the opportunity to have my main character back. Mm-hmm. But because the group I was with was very communicative, and because the DM was a good and patient soul, it all ended out for the best. It all ended up working very nicely. Character decisions were still made relevant, and the deaths that our characters experienced were not cheapened.
That's good. Yes. Now, I think both of you have said that communication is a vital part when it comes to PC deaths in this game, which is why
yes.
I spend a lot of time liberally to pause the game both before, if necessary, before a death could happen and after the death happens, to just reassess, you know, how people are feeling, what do the players want to do moving forward, because that's very important. I don't want to, as a GM, cheapen death, because death is supposed to be a big deal in games. But at the same time, I also want to make sure that the characters, that the players are still having fun and they're still playing a character that they're happy with. And even if the answer is, I really want to keep playing my character, I want to give them an avenue that they have to work towards. I don't want to do like a deus ex machina. Oh, the gods decided to just resurrect them again on the spot, because that wouldn't fly to me. So I wanted to have there be something that the characters have to do, some price to pay in order to allow the player to continue playing. And as I told Hannah in the last session, I was happy it happened in the sense that even before I started doing campaigns on the channel, with all my other campaigns, I have tended to be known as the GM who doesn't like killing off his players. Many, mm-hmm. many GMs don't have that problem. Many GMs have no issue for killing off their players. And it's not necessarily because I like the players so much, or I like the character so much, therefore I don't want to kill them. It's more because I tend to design stories that kind of require or kind of expect the characters to be there from beginning to end, because if they drop off, then the idea of these are the chosen people kind of gets like brushed under the carpet, and it doesn't really make as much sense. So I'm trying to, moving forward, make that less so in the plot, so that a character could die and it would still make sense in a narrative kind of way for them to die. Yep. So hopefully after last session, I no longer have that reputation. Oh, Hark's not going to kill us. He'll never kill us because that's not going to be true.
Guys from Hark's next campaign,
look out.
Yeah, look out. None of you are safe.
So. You're not safe.
Gloves are off.
That's funny.
So I'm curious then, Hark, how was it for you when it happened? Because you weren't expecting that going into the session.
No, So I did plan on, there were definitely points where, when I made this campaign, I designed it in a way that a death could definitely happen and may, in a narrative way, should happen because of the whole resurrection thing. Since I introduced the concept of resurrection in this campaign, I'm like, okay, I can kill off a character, and now there's this narrative about should we or shouldn't we.
Sure.
So I anticipated there to be a possible character death later, but the fact that Theobin volunteered to take on this procedure did surprise me. It did shock mm-hmm. me that he wanted to do that. I understood why he wanted to do that, but on the back of my head, I'm thinking, there's a 5% chance of survival here. How can I communicate this to Theobin in character that this is probably not the best thing to do, but that's what Theobin would do. So I had to roll with it. And I'm like, oh, the whole time I was like, oh gosh, I'm going to kill Theobin. Like, there's a 5% chance that he'll still be alive.
Yeah.
Granted, you made a bunch of rolls that included the 15%, but 15% isn't that great of odds either.
Yeah.
Right.
And so when Sam was like, are we just assuming that you know, Theobin's gonna live through this? And I was like, oh heck no. Like, right. Not at 5%. Heck no. I was like, I was at that point ready for Theobin to die. And of course I didn't want him to,
yeah.
But that's how the dice was rolled. So
no,
it was
I was
a shock to me.
Exactly the same. Yeah. So me as a player, the whole session, I was like, why are you doing this? Oh my god, you're going to kill yourself. You're my character. Don't do this. It was really frustrating for me.
But it was
I agonized over this for weeks.
She's been talking about it for a long time.
She was the only person in that chat that knew that Theobin was going to do that. And it over and over again, and I was just saying to Hark before we started recording, having rewatched the Mass Effect part that came up, actually there's quite a lot in there when you go back and rewatch it that indicates that Theobin would make this decision. He sure. talks about how he would die for Rosie, he talks about how he doesn't feel like he's enough for her. There's a lot actually that when it comes down to it, the bulk of this decision, which was to take that small chance, however it was, to be better for Rosie. Because as Giuseppe said, she was going to live a life full of uncertainty. She was going to have a lot of mental distress, migraines. And this was something he could give to her if it worked to make up for everything he felt he owed her.
Yeah. And then
it didn't pay off. But...
Yeah. The tragedy is, on one hand, you could give her everything. On the other hand, you could take everything away from her.
Yep.
So
yeah.
So therein lies the you know, pick your point, like, which is the a huge theme in this campaign throughout this game has been you have good intentions, and sometimes you think that the benefits outweigh the non-benefits. I mean, we saw that with the architect. He's like, I know something really, really bad could happen, but something really, really good could happen. And even if the chances of something really, really good happen could be smaller, the chances of that could be smaller than something bad happening, it's still worth me doing this because of the small chance that something really good happening. And of course, it didn't work out the way that the architect wanted, and it certainly didn't work out the way Theobin wanted. So...
No, but you can turn that round. People that make those decisions turn that round to say that nothing really, really good ever happened without risk.
Yeah.
Sure.
So that's, I mean, whether one outweighs the other is kind of a personal call, but that is the way that others might see it.
Yeah.
And for Theobin, it was an average father. I could be trying my best, but ultimately still not be able to give her what she needs. When I was role-playing it, I role-played it a lot like his daughter had a disability, because I have experience in that area, and I know that a lot of parents try so, so hard to accommodate their child's needs, and it's frustrating to them that, you know, they can't understand better, and they can't relate in the same way that their child really needs to be related to. And that kind of what I was trying to put across with the Oban, that he really wanted to go that extra mile to relate to Rosie and take all the lows with her.
Did you, as a player, I'm talking about you, Hannah, did you believe that that risk was worth taking for the Oban? I mean, obviously we know what the outcome was, but yeah. Did you believe that, knowing that he just told Rosie who he was, knowing that there was a risk of him promising to her that he was going to be there and then not being there now. Do you, yeah. Hannah, thought that
I was
saying
to Kimberly. Saying to Kimberly after the session, I was like, there is an argument there to say that the Oban shouldn't have said anything to Rosie, that he should have just let that lie if he was going to make that decision, or alternatively, just not make that decision. Me as a player, so thinking outside of Theoban's head, I wouldn't have taken that risk. I would have been an average parent rather than no parent. Exhibited a kind of interesting mentality. And it can be seen quite a lot, in which he always tends to put people first, and that never is him. It's never him. So ultimately, it wasn't about whether he lived or dies. Mm-hmm. It was about what he could give to Rosie in both circumstances. And that chance, however small, he could be better for her if he went through this decision. Me as a player, no, I wouldn't have done it.
Understood.
Yeah.
I have a question. Was it conscious that you didn't tell the other players how severe the risk was?
Oh, are you asking me that?
I'm asking Hannah.
Go ahead. Oh, go ahead.
Although that is a good question for Hark as well, because you did ping 15% on us, like, right as we were doing the roll.
But Theo knew that death was a possibility. The other players didn't. So I was just wondering.
No, he did not tell the other players that, no. He was, I don't know what to call it, because I don't think he was intentionally trying to be manipulative or unfair, but back when we first encountered the Dwarven Mages, he knew from the off what he wanted to do about that. But when he went back to the group, supportive. And that's, you know, just because of where we were in the campaign at that time, trust hadn't been built yet. But because of knockbacks like that, he very much didn't want the group to sway his decision. He didn't want the group to say, oh no, but you could die, don't do this. he had made the decision. And the only thing that he wanted the group's input on at that time was, you know, do I do this now, or will this impact the mission? If it impacts the mission, right. I will hold up. I don't want to, but it's not fair on everybody else if it does impact the mission. And in the end, it's something that nobody else could decide. It was Theo's choice, and Theo's choice would have been to do it and hope for the best, and that was what he did. Amusing point that the last thing that Theo said before he died was a sexual innuendo. I thought that was quite appropriate.
He
spent the last hour of his life pestering Zelinda, and I thought that was adorably accurate.
Yeah.
To answer Kimberly's question, then, if you wanted to address that to me, yes, I did purposely not give you an actual numerical value, because I didn't think that was natural for Zelinda. I don't think she would even knew what that number was. I don't think Cogs probably would. That would have been something Cogs could probably do, but I don't think Zelinda would have been able, like, oh yeah, 5%, 15% chance. That's not what she would say. So what she would say is, Theoban, the likelihood of you dying is super great. Are you sure you want me to do this? Yeah. So that's, I was trying to make it more organically obvious that your chances of surviving is very tiny. So.
No. So I think the aftermath was a really beautiful scene. Yeah. I think all of us talking about it afterwards was really powerful. I couldn't stop crying. So I don't know, you guys, but that was like my favorite scene in the maybe the whole campaign so far. It was really moving. So
yeah, I have to commend you guys and Sam as well. You know, all of you role played the aftermath so beautifully. I couldn't have been prouder of you guys. Yeah. Like, aww. You were genuinely mourning, and I really felt it. It was listening to it.
You get to watch your own funeral. It's
yeah.
People would pay bajillions of dollars to be able to do this.
Exactly.
Yeah. I'd
be like, okay, like so and so didn't show up. I'm gonna
exactly.
For Kimberly, I noticed that you were having a very hard time during because I knew you were feeling one way and Andrea was feeling another way.
Yeah.
So there was a little bit of internal turmoil, it seemed like.
Well, I Kimberly don't want Theoben to be dead forever, but Andrea is very like she's a free person now and she really wants to like hold on to her beliefs and
I'm glad that Andrea's character didn't have to bend in that session. I think that Rachel Palisair ended up having to bend, but I think of all the characters it makes the most sense for Palisair to.
Absolutely.
Considering everything she's been through and considering her relationship with Theoben, and as I said, she's cheated death before, so it would be hypocritical of her to be at least not open-minded to.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Always ask why.
Yes. So, but I think that'll be a very good role-playing opportunity for Halisair, because it's
absolutely
because I know that Halisair isn't really all that comfortable at all with what the Animagi are doing. So introducing now that things have gotten personal, I think that would be interesting to see her sort through. You know.
Yeah, and I'm actually really looking forward to having her sort through that. Yeah. Just like the thing that makes it the easiest for me to work into Hallie's story is, as of course you said, you know, she's been there before. She's already kind of questioning her own whys and all that. And the thing that there was one moment that really kind of clinched it for me, and that was before we even knew that, you know, Theo was going to die. Mm-hmm. When they were trying to figure out the ins and outs of how the resurrection crystal was working, because it was the question of what to do with Maphareth's soul, because you know, he was tremendously evil, but does that mean he is deserving of not existing? Mm-hmm. Not existing versus being punished. Mm-hmm. So that was her questioning that, like, if not for that very particular subject, she might have had a little bit more of a hard time making the decision to help Theo. Mm-hmm. So thanks, guys. That was
an interesting conversation in and of itself, because you're like, well, doesn't he not existing versus not being punished? And Andrea's not religious, so she's like,
right.
What's going to save more people? Otherwise, I don't care.
And normally she'd be right there with you, but it's just, there's so much unknown and so much of the entire world kind of rests on this hope. And just, it's an intricate puzzle. It's going to be so much fun to talk about it.
Can I ask, Rachel, if you don't mind getting into Halisair for a second? I'm just very curious as to what exactly her thought process was when she decided to take Theo's soul.
Oh, do I want to say that now or do I want to say that later?
It's up to you.
I want to say that later. That's perfectly fine. I was personally curious, but if you want to...
If you're going to answer later...
Reveal that in session, that's fine.
We can talk about in session.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think I'm going to keep that a no spoiler for now.
Okay.
Okay, no worries.
No spoilerino.
One of... I remember during the session, I promised you that I would tell you a little story about me and trying to stay in character, despite the fact that me as a player didn't want my character to act a certain way.
Or oh, sure.
It wasn't necessarily that my character acted a certain way. It was just she was put into a situation. Let me start from the beginning. So this is a slightly long story.
Okay.
So just bear with me just to set things up. So this was my very first... Mm-hmm. Real story heavy tabletop experience, because I had played D&D for the first time with my roommates in college, and they were very much combat after combat after combat type.
Yeah.
Not very much. There was a story, but that wasn't the emphasis. We didn't spend time talking to each of the NPCs or PCs for hours on end. That just wasn't what we did. We just killed things and got loot. And that was what I thought D&D was. And then I started playing with my friend who is the DM who just opened my eyes to the story. And that kind of helped shape me to be the kind of person who appreciated story, not only in tabletop games, but in video games in general. And I loved how the PCs developed these relationships with each other as we continued through the campaign. It was awesome. So my character was a female elf, and there was another player who was playing a human rogue, and our characters, like, we bickered with each other constantly. Like, we always gave each other a hard time and constantly got on each other's nerves for a good half of the campaign. And then something happened. Like, I don't remember what it was, but I think we were about to do some sort of mission. It was going to be a very risky mission. And my character was the best equipped to accomplishing this mission on her own, but it placed her at great risk. And his character was like, no, you shouldn't go there alone. You know, that's not, you know, we have to think of another plan. We have to think of another idea. And of course, she was like, oh, you think I can't handle it? Is that why? And he's like, no, it's not like that at all. And then we just had this big back and forth argument. And then I don't remember what exactly my character said, but she said something along the lines like, oh, you know, it's almost for a moment there, I thought you actually cared about my well-being. And then he says, of course I care about your well-being. And then there was like this awkward pause. And none of this was planned. There was this awkward pause. And then me, the player, and him, the player, looking at each other, and we're like, oh my God, are our two characters actually like have been falling in love with each other this entire time? And it was a huge... And we, again, without saying anything to each other, we just continued role-playing. And I was like, oh my God, my character is totally in love with this other character. And he kind of saw it too. And our DM was like on the floor, like loving this, because I don't think he saw it either, because he thought we actually hated each other. So our characters started to fall in love, and then we started a relationship. And then, and it was a little awkward out of character too, because I sort of had a little crush on the player, but I mean, it wasn't like, you know, anything was going to happen, because he was married and we were playing at his house with his wife in the kitchen. So that was a little awkward. But so, you know, here I am and him, like, having these very intimate moments. And meanwhile, you know, his wife is in the kitchen, like, listening and all of this. So I felt really awkward for the longest time, but it's cool. But it was cool, because later on he told me that his wife, after we would finish a session, his wife would actually come to him and be like, "So how are your character and Hark's character doing?" Like she was actually interested in seeing how the relationship was blossoming. And I thought that was just the coolest thing.
She was shipping
us. No, she was totally shipping us. It was so cool. It was so funny. So eventually,
that's awesome.
Our characters ended up. She got pregnant. She got pregnant, and you know, we were starting to plan for a wedding, and then the players like threw a baby shower for me, and everything is super cool.
That's so cute.
It was really really cool. The baby shower was probably one of my favorite role playing in a long time. And so here's where we get to the problem, and the problem is my character's pregnant. We still haven't saved the world yet. It would be weird for my character to want to continue adventuring, putting herself in danger, knowing not only that she's putting herself in danger, but also the unborn child of her and the person that she loves is in danger. So we were trying to figure out, outside of the session with the GM, how are we going to get around this? Because I obviously want to play my character, but it would make the most sense for her to stop questing and for me to roll another character. So we ended up spending some time with the GM and was able to figure out something. But it was one of those things where I've discovered firsthand how interesting it is when your character has a mind of their own and you're sort of trying to sidestep around them to compensate for the fact that your character would do this realistically, but you, the player, still want to do something else so that you get to play the way you want to play. So.
Yep.
Did you get around it in the end? How did you arrange so that happened?
So the GM came up with a magic, because magic fixes everything, a magical ritual that essentially allowed me to have a surrogate to carry my child while I was adventuring. Oh. So one of my trusted female NPCs, you know, volunteer to go through the ritual to carry our child so that we could save the world. And then if we survive, then our child could be born and we live happily ever after, which fortunately it did. So yes.
Yay!
Cedric takes down notes, check up on this character, creepy magic ritual baby.
Creepy baby.
Oh man. Yeah, it's hard sometimes because you know that your character's going to act a certain way, but you're like, we still want to have fun as a group, so we've got to figure out a way around it. So,
and again, I'm really not being trite when I say this. I'm really proud of this group for being able to not only stop and talk so openly about it, but to understand that sometimes you have to work things out of character to make sure everyone can still have the fun that they want to have in character.
Exactly.
Good job, guys.
Good job, everybody.
I think I 100% agree with what you just said, but I think the other way has to happen as well, because Kimberly and I were talking about something like
a while ago.
Yeah, it was a while ago. About how sometimes you make your characters kind of forget things, like especially for Cedric, because he's a Templar and he's traveling with an apostate mage, and like there's just a bunch of things that it's like, all right, we're just gonna like kind of pretend that person's not there. Especially Violetta.
Specifically Violetta.
Yeah. It got to a point.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
I'm sorry.
It got to a point.
It just got to a point where I was like, I don't think Cedric is cool with this. Like, every time like she's brought up, he's like pounding on my mind, like, you need to say something. And I'm like, no, group dynamics. And then it just got to a point where like the part with the bracer came up and like Cedric just wouldn't hold back anymore, and he was like, I'm not cool with this, I don't want to give her the bracer. And
Let's talk about Violetto. Thank you for that segue.
That's a beautiful segue.
Very nice segue. Let's talk about, go ahead, talk about Violetta.
Violetta. I tried, Hark. I think she's cool out of character, but I was
here's something I've always been curious about, and this is not at all attacking what you guys ended up doing, because I think what you guys did is makes perfect sense, but I'm just curious where, besides the whole thing with the eye, like if we took the eye out of the equation, like I'm just curious where the thought that Violetta would steal something from you guys, like where that came from, because I don't think that me as a player was playing that up at all, or was like trying to role play that up at all, because I'm trying to figure out where is it, does the character, is it just because Cedric has this preconceived notion about what apostate mages are like? Because I did say in her background that she's fascinated by magic items. I mean, I can be fascinated by magic items. Anybody can be fascinated by magic items. It doesn't necessarily mean that I would necessarily steal a magic item from my party, per se. So I'm just curious where that came from.
I think for me, it was when we very first met her. Okay. We first met her, we went into a caravan type thing, and it was full of cursed items.
Sure.
And Andrea knew that. And she kept asking questions and being very persistent about asking questions. Then she'd back off after a while, but she was very curious as to what was going on with our bracers and why the Illuviana was working, and that really creeped her out. She didn't like that.
Gotcha.
And then for me, like, it started to get better, and it started to get better, and then the Trina thing happened, and I'm like, well, Trina's not, like, okay. Andrea's not going to trust this woman anymore. And then right after Trina was the eye. So,
right. So it was the... It was just the curiosity that made you think that, she's curious about this, therefore she might want to steal it.
And she's a collector. She's a collector of cursed items.
But she does, but I don't think I've ever made any implication that anything in her wagon was ever stolen or unlawfully taken. I don't think I ever made that implication.
No, but I feel like it just sketched me. It's
getting totally
me
understand.
As Kimberly
totally
and Andrea understand. Out. Like, yeah. like, why does she have all these cursed items? What would be the purpose for that?
Yeah, it was more of a curiosity from my standpoint, because I'm like, am I really role playing her that way? Like, maybe it's me. It's like, because like, I don't think I was role playing her in that way. So that's why I just asked that question. Go ahead, Kevin.
Yeah, I was just gonna agree with Kimberly. Like, Kimberly actually was the first person to bring it up to me, and like, oh, okay. Like, I can kind of see how Cedric would think that as well, and you know, stuff like that. And it, like Kimberly, it did kind of get better. I mean, it was always gonna be uneasy because she is an apostate, and
right.
Like, yeah, so there was always going to be that uneasy kind of distrustfulness, but she was helping the group, and he was kind of, like, slowly being accepting. Like, not like, hey, buddy, welcome, but like, all right, you can come with the group, and I won't, like, have to keep an eye on you 24/7. Like, kind of like an Andrea situation, where it's like,
yeah,
I know... you're not a full circle mage yet, but I kind of trust you enough to where like we can split up with the party, and I know you won't do something stupid, or you won't do something evil.
Does Cedric or Andrea feel a little bad or guilty about Violetta leaving? Okay, Cedric has absolutely no, he's like doesn't care whatsoever. How about Andrea?
I only feel bad that the party's kind of irritated with me. Otherwise, I don't care. Andrea was like, it was more like a relief. Like, thank God she's finally gone. I don't have to keep an eye on this anymore.
Did Andrea conveniently forget that if Violetta wasn't with you, Boswick would be dead right now, possibly, and you would still have been blissfully unaware of Trina, if not for her? Did she?
Yeah. Yeah, because because she just doesn't trust her. Like, I mean, yes, she that happened, but it wasn't that she wanted her to leave so much as I don't trust you fully. And if that's going to make Violetta leave, well, then Andrea is okay with that. She's like, well, I don't have to, you know.
Yeah, you don't have to, you know, walk on thin ice or whatever it is. Watch what I'm saying or doing around it. I totally get that. Totally understand that.
So,
well, I mean, I don't feel like I can speak for Halsey because they have their own history. But I just want to say on behalf of Theo, she was cool with us. We liked her, and as players as well, we love her character, like Kimberly and Kevin probably do. But kind of dead for that scene, so I couldn't.
Yeah, yeah, I know you couldn't say anything.
But there is a lot of points that you've raised, Hark, that Theoben would have mentioned himself. And in fact, I do have it planned when Theoben finds out this detail to have a bit of a talk.
Yay!
So
good.
I have to admit, it was Violetta deciding to leave was a surprise to me, actually, because I wasn't expecting on there being any more critical instances like we had one with Hugh, and we had one with Razakale. I wasn't necessarily expecting it to happen to any of the other NPCs, and then during the bracer scene I was like, all right, if I was Violetta, I'd probably be like, all right guys, peace out. So that took me by surprise. Took me by big surprise. I did not plan that at all, so.
No, but I am totally supportive of that because, she acted very well and very much in accordance with how I honestly think a lot of us might have acted if we were snubbed that often. And that, I guess, is the other half of the in-character versus out-of-character thing that we were just talking about. When it comes to big decisions like, oh, hey, my character's dead, we should stop and talk and see how everything's going. I also really like the fact that there's that other side of the story where, if your character makes perfectly reasonable for their character actions, that there will still be consequences. Yeah. It's that beautiful fine line, and I loved it. And Hallie is so pissed about that.
I think it'll be funny if Hallie talks to Andrea, because Andrea will be like, I was just honest. What? She asked me and I said no. What did I do wrong?
You were honest. Yeah.
I just want to ask a question. I don't mean for this to come out pointed or accusatory or anything. Please do not say this in a bad way at all.
No worries.
But I do have to ask, did Andrea ever really give Violetta a chance, though? Because I remember very early on, like, it was just, nope, bad person, shade, you know, we had an argument in character because the fact that you were a slave came up in front of Violetta. Like, from the get-go, it felt like, this is a bad person and I want nothing to do with you. That chance that Violetta could have redeemed herself.
She was starting to. Like I said, she was starting to warm up to her. I started to talk to her just a little bit, which for Andrea is a big deal, but not much. Not much. She always felt like that edge. Because the woman collects creepy stuff. It freaked her out. it just weirded her out. She tried for the group's sake because the group wanted her with them, and she was helpful. And the Bostwick situation was really a step in the right direction. But I don't know. Like I feel like no.
I think on a deep level, story-wise, it might even make a bit of sense because, you know, Andrea spent her entire life fighting to stay alive just by nature of what she spent most of her life doing. And so having your back deliberately turned to a potential enemy is probably something that, whether or not she realizes it, is going to just be poking at the back of her mind. So the fact that she was introduced to the group and then publicly got some really important information on you is like, oh, hey, here's this person you don't know yet, don't trust, and here's the dagger that she can slip right into your back. Yes. So it makes sense to me on a story level. Yeah, yeah. It totally does.
Yeah, it makes sense.
Well, it wasn't even just Theo. It was the fact that she brought up Bostwick the very first like conversation they had. Andrea's like, why would you bring him up? Like, that's just so weird. Like, what is going on?
I felt like that was more the GM being like, oh look, there's this connection here that, you know, Violetta knows Bostwick. I think that's probably what that was.
Yeah, for me, the player, it was more of a, oh, you know, like, you're from the Vitter. Do you know this person? I know this person. Oh, cool. And that was it. For me personally, that was all it was.
So, for Andrea, it was a threat. Like,
yeah, for Andrea, it was a threat. So,
like, do you know Bostwick? I'm going to kill you in your sleep, just so you know.
So I think I was very much in character then, because the player was oblivious to the gravity of what she was saying. So she was oblivious to the gravity as well.
For Andrea, though, if she thinks you're going to be a threat, getting close doesn't make sense, because someday she might have to kill you. So yeah. It just didn't make sense.
Hmm. Or they might kill themselves.
I think out of character with the whole Violetta leaving, I do feel kind of bad, especially for like Cedric's choices. Like, something that bothered me after I made that like decision to just say like, no, I don't trust it, was that he gave the bracer to Eric. And it's like, why is that any better, Cedric? You're an idiot.
Yeah, yeah. But then I really noticed.
I thought about it a little bit more, and he felt that we were giving the bracer to Violetta. Like, all right, use the bracer in Theo's stead. The reason why he gave it to Eric was we weren't going to give him the bracer. There was no way that was going to happen. So that's how I kind of justified it in my head. But when I first said it, I was like, wow, that was a stupid choice.
I feel it worth pointing out, given that it was Theo's bracer, that had Theo have been alive, I think you guys know who he would have wanted to have it. And it would not have been Eric. It would have been Violetta.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, Cedric really wanted to give it to the person wearing the burgundy robes. Really wanted to give it to the burgundy person.
Yeah.
But it was because he knew that it was going to be a temporary thing until he could get it to the Circle Mage, which is who, in the end, he actually wanted to use the bracelet.
Is it because he thought that he might be able... Is it because deep down inside, Cedric felt that he might be able to take Eric more than he could take Violetta?
Maybe.
Okay, that makes me feel a little better.
Like, I mean, who knows? She could have snipped some of his hair in the like since they first met. Like, you don't know what those apostates have up their sleeves. Mm-hmm. They're always unpredictable and the order
technically Eric is also an apostate.
Yeah, but also, she can't, technically, if he slips his hair, it's just weird.
You travel with one.
Yeah,
hey man, I've got written permission from a senior enchanter to be on this mission.
And she's expressed willingness to go to a circle. Violetta, I don't think, to my knowledge, has ever expressed that.
Why would she? She has to lead her own people. Like, hey guys, I'm just gonna go. You're never gonna see me again. The tree's in charge now. Bye.
Well, I'm not saying it's not justified. I'm just saying that she never expressed that.
No, the tree's in charge now. It's happened.
Oh, the tree's in charge. Got
yes.
It. The tree's in charge.
Yep.
That can cause some problems.
Yeah. Oh, we can actually get the chance to find Owlet a date. That's really important to me. I want to find him a date.
I do too. I'm thinking a peach tree might be good. Like,
I was really hoping we would find something over in Kenna's lands, because, yeah. Soon, Owlet. Soon.
Maybe.
Soon, maybe
that. Buddy. We'll see what happens. Maybe.
We'll find you some love, buddy.
We'll see where you guys go next. So.
Oh, man. Maybe it's a finale thing, maybe.
The last the end. Big thing for the session was Navarra.
Yeah.
And there was a lot of craziness there.
How you feeling about that there, Cedric?
Yeah, Cedric.
Kevin's so speechless.
Okay. Well, first, like, the necklace thing was a big deal to him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I actually have a question about that. So he got back all of Liam's memories from, like, pretty much start to finish.
Correct, he does.
So, did Cedric know who the heroes of Ferelden were beforehand?
It sounded like you did, didn't you?
Yeah, okay. Well, I mean, like, I thought I did, but then it was like, okay, well, wait, did Cedric only start having his own memories from when he got let out of the box? Yeah. So, does that mean he doesn't remember, like, anything?
So they never, okay, out of character, they hadn't had a chance to explain this to you. But out of character, when you first woke up, you don't remember your initial waking up because your memories were still wonky. You didn't know who you were. And the Ani Magi were trying to help you figure out who you were. So in order to help you function, at least, and not be totally lost, they were able to at least update in your memory most recent events. So that at least you're not like totally, what's going on? Who are all these people? Where am I? So they were able to at least give you recent events, that general public news. So you knew as much about the heroes of Ferelden that the common person knew.
Okay, okay.
So that never got breached. I don't know if it will get breached, but I'm telling you guys now behind the scenes, that's what happened.
Gotcha.
Oh, man. I know Kevin was rewatching all of the sessions with Liam to figure out what he knows now, like in between sessions.
I was taking notes.
Yes.
Because they did specifically talk about getting, like, time magicked or whatever.
Yeah.
He didn't believe him at first, but it kept saying it. And now with the knowledge that he knows now, he's like, uh-oh.
Yeah. He does know. I mean, the big thing I think people worried about is he does know about Delwyn. Mm-hmm. But he doesn't know everything about Delwyn.
Yeah.
He knows about blood magic, but not just steel, right?
Yeah. I don't think that Liam ever really had a deep conversation with Delwyn about his blood maginess in season one. I think he, of course, showed his disapproval. And, I mean, it wasn't like he really was besties with Delwyn to begin with. But I think he ended up having a... like the eventual Maximilian attitude towards Delwyn. So I don't think that they had a very big discussion about it.
You know, let's get Shelly in here and we'll just, you know, RP that out right now.
Let's do that. Let's
come on, Shelly, you know you want to.
You know, a big part of this campaign, I was really worried about that. Like, oh God, Blood Mage, Cedric, it's just not gonna. But as I was rewatching season one, Liam specifically was saying, like, he said, now we're even, and he didn't kill her at that point. And I think, like, after watching that, I kind of like, you know, maybe it doesn't have to be that bad. He did get permission from the divine, and like, there's that history there where it's like, all right, I've given you this chance, and from what I can tell, you haven't been practicing blood magic. So I was worried at first, but now I'm like, okay, I'm not that worried now. Unless he's been practicing blood magic, I'm not really that worried about
it. Well, the conditions, not that you necessarily would know that off the top of your head, but remember from the finale of last session or the epilogue, the condition was he was not allowed to. If he was caught, then his amnesty would be cut. So I think that the implication right now is that his dragon magic is just as powerful, if not more powerful, than his blood magic anyway. Mm-hmm. So that would
be. Yeah, yeah.
So in other words, you're giving Delwyn a second chance.
Yeah.
just like Cedric was given a second chance, whether he wanted it or not.
That word came up in session one as well, and I chuckle to myself.
You have second chance still in your possession.
Yeah.
I hope you've been using your second chance well, Delwyn. We know who you are.
One thing that I wish I brought up was Liam and Connor, was with Liam and Connor, and the sword.
Yeah,
I feel like that was a big thing that I completely just blanked out on. But I mean, it can be brought up later.
You can bring that up later.
Yeah. It was like one of those things where it's like, and that's the end of the session. And I go downstairs and get something to eat, and I'm like eating. And I'm like, oh, I should have talked about the sword.
Yeah.
That's okay.
I want my sword back.
Give me that.
I had a GM question, if there's nothing else anyone wants to talk about in that subject. In one of our previous vlogs, you mentioned that if Cedric had have got on better with Thomas than he had Hugh, way back when in session one, it would have been Thomas on the ship rather than Hugh.
Yes.
How would the Trelef Thompson thing have worked out if that had happened, if Cedric, for whatever reason, sided with the rapist?
Then it would not have been, Trelef Thompson's name on the box.
Okay. That makes sense.
It would have been somebody else's name on the box.
This would it be? Or
which
would you have
may,
to create like
may
a
or may not directly correlate back to Hugh. That's all I'm going to say. May or may not correlate back to Hugh. So.
Cool.
Yeah.
That was one of those, made the right choice there.
That was one of those things where, yeah, I mean, it was one of those things where I was playing with the idea of one of the character or the other. Me as a GM, I was more attached to Hugh's character, so I was hoping that was the route that Cedric was going to go, but it was up to Kevin, really, up to that point. So if he did end up going with being more friends with Trelef than with Hugh, then I was ready to adjust the plot in that direction instead. So.
Oh.
It sounds like Kevin is happy with his choice.
Yeah.
Oh man, yeah. Trelef.
Yeah.
Do you guys buy? So we met Simon, which was somebody from Cedric's past, and I think we already talked about how he provided some really interesting perspectives, whether you agree with them or not. And another way of looking at what the Animagi are doing. And he mentioned
As a side point, Hark, mm-hmm. I wish you hadn't have picked the name Simon, because I keep thinking of the creepy murderer from Mass Effect.
Kevin picked the name. It was Kevin's character, Kevin's NPC. So
random name generator.
I didn't pick, I didn't pick the name Simon. That was all Kevin. So, go ahead.
I like hearing the other perspective. I don't think Andrea would agree with it, but
yeah,
she would respect it.
You were doing a lot of head shaking.
Yeah, like I was like the whole time. but I liked hearing the other perspective from somebody who didn't just seem like a fanatic. Because no offense to the kids, but they seem pretty fanatical in their
beliefs.
Exactly.
Simon seems to have a more grounded, I guess, take on it.
Yeah.
He didn't say Simon Says.
He didn't say no relation. I'm gonna say that it's no relation to that character whatsoever. Do you guys? I'm not talking about your characters, but I guess I'm curious from the player perspective. Again, we're talking about second chances here. Simon was explaining that Trelef Thompson was trying to reinvent himself because of some of the things that he did in the past and wanted to make himself a better person moving forward, giving him a second chance, so to speak. Do you guys buy that as players? I'm just curious. No, okay. Andrea, Kimberly doesn't buy it.
I do not at all. Kimberly, like, absolutely does not.
Do not buy that. Okay.
He's working for some evil or something. Yeah, I don't trust that.
Yeah, out of character, I'm with Kimmy. I don't trust it for a second, mm-hmm. but our currently questioning everything Helisair might pause. And okay. that might hurt somebody or that might help somebody, but we don't know.
We don't know.
I actually have the benefit of playing a really distrustful character, so so if I don't trust somebody, neither does Andrea. She's like,
yeah. Yeah. I'm kind of jealous.
I know.
How about Kevin or Hannah?
I like the idea.
Okay.
Of trying to reinvent yourself, especially if you have a sketchy past. I'm all for second chances. No, okay.
Mm-hmm. Hey.
But.
And you're dead.
A resurgence, if you would say.
Yeah.
A resurgence.
But.
With my head.
I think that there are some things that are just inexcusable.
Okay.
Murder and attempted rape is something that is inexcusable. And I don't care how much you reinvent yourself, you're always going to be that person.
Good point.
Like, you can mask it as much as you want, but it's not going to change deep down inside.
Valid point. How about you, Hannah?
I think I'm with Kevin on this. I definitely, on principle, don't think it's a bad thing to reinvent yourself and travel on from your past. But yeah, there's a line. And certain things are not going to, and certain things are also difficult to come back from or change one's mindset to.
Yeah.
And things like the examples he brought up, murder, attempted rape, those kind of things, if you're willing to do that as a person, that's not going away, that stays with you. That's how I see it.
Okay. And I think the other person that we talked about very briefly was Hugh. There's a little bit of Hugh in this session.
A little bit.
Yes. Oh, Hugh.
We don't know where he is, and we don't know yet how to use those paintings.
Yeah, the funny thing about the Hugh scene is I could feel the group going, let's go get him.
Yeah, we don't want him to right then. We're like, oh, let's go find him. And the NPCs are like, I'm pretty sure that's not what he wants. And we're like, we don't care.
We don't care. We're going to get him anyway. We are
saving somebody that we love this session.
The NPCs talked us down, but we were like, we want to go get him right now.
It has been three sessions. Oh.
Well, you know what you have to do before that's safe to do. You know what you have to do before that's safe to do. So just throw it out there.
I'm worried that his tranquility might be kind of going away anyway, because he's able to do, I didn't know he could do magic as far away as he's able to do it now. That seems like really powerful. So I'm like, I feel like our time frame is shrinking. Like we need to do it soon.
And wasn't there a hint that you mentioned, Hawk, as well? Something to do with the style of painting that he was tapping into an emotion or so? There was some kind of hint in session. The tranquility is maybe fading a little bit. I can't remember exactly what it was. But
he said that he's never painted anything that he didn't see before that wasn't there.
Right.
And he is
he's
now.
Not creative.
Oh, yeah,
he's
that's
not
right.
creative. So he's adding something that
that's
wasn't
right.
even seen before. The the painting, if you remember, is unfinished.
Yeah.
It looks like he's finishing it. So I think, is there anything else before we close?
My point on Simon, okay. I agree with Kimberly. I love hearing about the other side of the thing. Cause when you're in the mindset of a character who has been hating like what the anime guy are doing for like since session one, pretty much, even though he didn't know who they were,
yeah.
it was kind of refreshing to hear someone who liked, I at least was supportive of what they were doing. And I did like the part where he was like, I'm a Templar, I will always be a Templar. And if you can give me more chances to continue being a Templar, I'll take it.
Yeah.
And I kind of like, out of character, I gained a little bit of respect for him with that. Like I kind of could see where he was coming from, and but Cedric didn't. But yeah, I just wanted to throw that in there. I did like what you did with Simon with that.
I liked that Cedric mentioned, and he's entitled to that, as I think is what Simon said, that he felt he was ripped away from the clutch, from the embrace of the Maker, just to be brought back here. And his argument was, of course you're entitled to go back to the Maker. He felt like if the Maker allows him to come back to continue to serve him, he would do it. He wouldn't rest on his laurels yet, or he wouldn't rest yet if he could still keep going. So it was interesting to be able to see that argument, to see back and forth.
Yeah. And then there was that one conversation with Hallie where I was like, you can't tell me to turn off being a Templar and then turn it on when it's convenient.
Good. Yeah, I like that.
It was like good because it's been building for so long. Yeah, like,
I like
we keep telling Cedric, you know, well, especially Andrea, be a Templar. And then like later on, they want him to soften up on certain things. And finally, he's like, had enough. That was so nice to see.
Yeah, yeah, that was very good.
It was very liberating.
So on my list, something that stuck in my head ever since last session is how Kenna communicated with Rosie.
Yes.
The biotics were making the mind tremble, and how she talked to Rosie. That stuck with me. That still plays in my head. It was so good.
Yeah, totally.
So I think that was amazing therapy on Sam's part.
And her speech
was really good.
Her speech to her brothers was very
brothers.
Compelling.
Very compelling. Loved that.
The approach that she had, which was, you know, I'm going to put my all into this discussion. If you still go off and make mistakes, then that's on you. But I'm going to do everything I can to try to convince you that this isn't the right way. So,
and it was,
I also liked that she said if they do what they want to do anyway, then the consequences would be theirs. And I'm like, oh, so she's saying right now, you know, there will be consequences if you do this. And
and I like
the consequences are kind of standing behind her, like it's us.
And I like how how she was able to handle a very, very tricky aspect of the brother's argument, which was their mom. He's like I know what my mom said to you guys, but she's the past and I'm the future, which is a very ballsy thing to say about your mom. My mom's the past and I'm the future. So I understand what she was trying to say, but when she said, I was like, whoo, wow. Yeah. I don't think I'd be able to say that about my mom. Wow.
Such a great moment. Yeah. I may have developed a little bit of a crush on her at that point.
It was a huge development point for her, because when you look back at Kenna at the very beginning of the campaign, she was very reliant on that idea of her mother and the Avar and doing them proud. And that was her statement.
Yes.
It happened. I am the present future of the Avar race, as are you, and that's not coming back.
And she brandished that staff. She's like, I'm in charge. Like, this is what this means.
This is what this means, yes, very much so.
I am in charge. You guys are beholden unto me. So it was so cool. It was so
That. I love that.
So deal with it.
Yeah.
Deal with it.
Get on my level.